Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the SBI Hangar for the session No Regrets, Choices Women Must Make. In the panel today, we have Nirmala Govindarajan, Nimi to a lot of us. She is an author, journalist, and a social sector documentarian. Her new novel, Taboo, is inspired by underage girls who are kidnapped and trafficked. Her recent novel, Hunger's Daughter, is born out of her experience of documenting India's rural heartland. She's also authored The Community Catalyst, which is in the recommended reading for civil services aspirants, and co-authored Mindblocks 1.0. Nirmala co-curated the debut Times Literary Carnival and debuted the Literary Round series at the British Council in Bangalore. She's also pioneered the Writer's Yatra and the Reader's Yatra experiences in offbeat locations. She dabbles in theater, plays the Western classical piano and the violin. Joining her is Kaveri Bamzai, an independent journalist and the first and so far the only woman editor of India Today till January last year. She is the author of No Regrets, The Guilt-Free Woman's Guide to a Good Life. Joining them is Anuja Chauhan, an army brat born in Meerut and educated in Meerut, Delhi and Melbourne. She's worked in the advertising for over 17 years and is credited with many popular campaigns, including PepsiCo's Ye Dil Mange More, Mera Number Kab Aayega, Oi Bubbly and Dar Ke Aage Jeet Hai. She's the author of 4 best-selling novels, The Zoya Factor, Battle for Bitora, Those Pricey Thakur Girls, and The House That PJ Built, 2 of which have been optioned by major Bollywood studios, and 1 of which has been made into a primetime daily Hindi serial and on Aunt TV. They are in conversation with Tanushree Ghosh, who works in the technology sector in the US and has a doctorate in chemistry from the Cornell University. She's also a social activist and a writer. She's a contributor to the Huffington Post US and The Logical Indian. Many of her literary works have been featured in national and international magazines, including the anthologies such as Defiant Dreams and the Best Asian Short Stories 2017. She is also the author of From Another Land, her first single author book. She is the founder and director of Her Rights, a nonprofit committed to furthering the cause of gender equality. Please join me in welcoming Nirmala Govindarajan, Kaveri Bamzai, Anuja Chauhan in conversation with Tanushree Ghosh.
Okay, so welcome everyone, and welcome my fellow panelists. I'm very excited for this topic. This is very close to my heart. So I wanted to start actually with the question of choices. Why is it mostly in context of women? And I wanted to start with you, Kaveri. Is it because mostly women didn't have many choices, or is it because men and women's choices are fundamentally different, no matter what we are, where we are talking about?
Well, I think recently I watched The Marriage Story, and there's this character played by Laura Dern, and I think she puts it very well. She says, for 30 years, women have always been the parent, you know? Yep. And men have only now understood or have been made to understand that they can be the parent too. So I think women's choices were always circumscribed, you know, within a certain domesticity. Yes, she was, you know, she could work, but that was really the extent of it. But I think over the years, I think we've seen that men who I believe are also victims of patriarchy, perhaps sometimes more than women, I think they seem to have also understood that if the family has to survive, it cannot survive as it is right now. I think the family unit has to change. It has to become more dynamic. It's what Anne-Marie Slaughter says. The primary caregiver has to keep changing. You know, it can be the man for maybe a certain period of time, the woman for a certain period of time. But I think where women's choices have increased is in the public sphere. And I think that is what is most exciting to me. When I see mothers and grandmothers in Shaheen Bagh, you know, shouting out their rage or just sitting there and, you know, talking about what matters to them, that is them exercising their choice in the public sphere. And I think that is what is most unusual. that women have actually reclaimed the public sphere. They know that, you know, that old question of work-life balance, it's not just work and life anymore, it's the public sphere also, it's society at large. They have learned that there are choices outside work and life, that they can actually engage with society, and they're showing us every day. They've been showing us for the past, what, more than a month, that, you know, when they get angry, they really know how to show their rage.
So I think that is actually an interesting point that I also wanted to ask about, and I will maybe move to Anuja for that question. So you mentioned that, you know, yes, women are historically probably did not have that much choices of working or in the public sphere or voices. I also feel that did men have much choice like to not work? Like, you know, I feel this burden you mentioned about that patriarchy puts on men also, that, hey, you have to be the protector, the breadwinner and that. So,
like, is this working? Am I loud?
Yeah.
Okay. No, you're right. I think men and boys growing up are given, their world is very narrow in the sense that it's very clear to them that you have to provide, you have to be a breadwinner, you have to put, you know, food on the table and be a good provider. They are being raised to be providers, more or less. That's, we're all guilty of doing that. And I think that does, you know, like what Kaveri is saying about things like women sitting in Shaheen Bagh, protesting, being the conscience of a nation. Men don't really have the option of doing that so much because they are going out then saying, okay, I will earn a living, and which in a sense is nicer for us as a gender because we get to do this other very important work. Surely the conscience of a nation is more important than putting food on a table. Yep. And in that sense, there are some perks of the gender we are born in because we can take a wider role and do these other things that men don't have the social sanction perhaps to do so much.
Okay, and then...
Also, just to intervene, sorry, before Nirmala steps in. I think it's also women of a certain age. You know, we've tended to see women over 50 as, okay, now, you know, their mothers, they'll soon be grandmothers and that's it. Women over 50, and I think they are going to be the most powerful agents of change in this country. They've done their bit for the family. Look at Mrs. Alva. They've done their bit for the family. They've done their bit for whatever corporate behemoth they're working for. And now they feel, you know, it's time. Menopause is very liberating. Please. So now they feel that this is the time that they can actually step out and make, you know, actually say what's on their mind. I think that is what is interesting. And I think, Nirmala, you see this more in villages as well.
Yep.
Much more than in urban areas. Maybe, you know, sorry, yeah. But I think that's something that's very interesting to me.
Yeah, no, I think actually that's almost never talked about, actually, the age factor in choices and the stereotyping of, like, divisions. But, Nirmala, yeah, so wanted you to add on this choice question, how does it look in the segments you work in, the rural segments?
Yeah, thanks Times of India for this platform. And thank you, Tanushri, for this question and for this lovely panel. I think in India, especially in the rural areas as we stand, very few people have the ability to make choices at all. You know, be it men or women, because they are, like, you know, brought into us. Like, you look at the number of deaths that happen because they are intermarrying, or, you know, because they want to do diverse things. They're not able to take up different, jobs as apart from what they already do. But then when it comes to the women, like, when I was working on the story on a civil servant, Bharatlal Meena, I spent some time in Rajasthan, in his Meena village. In Sawai Madhopur district, and I stayed in his house. His mother, an 85-year-old woman, was still running to the fields, still the boss lady, still sitting there and smoking her, hookah. And there were all these younger women who were, like, in their gungats, right? You don't know, I don't even think Mr. Meena knows how his brother's wife looked. I mean, if she were to remove the gungat. And even Mr. Meena himself had been married off at a very young age, at the age of 16, it was practically child marriage. And I learned through that experience that marriage happens because people need people to move from, the woman to move from one house to the other, be a form of support over there, help with the agriculture, help with the household work and everything, right? And then moving on to villages in Orissa, right, and Jharkhand, where I worked on my other two novels, which Hunger's Daughters, especially where I was working with this organization, Development Focus, I met these little girls, all young breadwinners, you know. The first time I went and landed up in the village was this little child whose mother had left her. And her father had died many years ago and she was home alone. And she was to interact with us that day, right? And, but then there was this organization that was working with them and they had enabled her to rear ducks and make a living. She was teaching other children and they had this little Bal Panchayat where other children watched out for these kids and brought them. But then the day we landed up there, this child was nowhere to be seen. And we waited at the village school for an hour and a half, and then one of the kids said, let's go to a house. It's just a tiny street in that far-flung forest hamlet in the midst of some Naxal, camps. And I went there and we walk into this hutment and another little room within that hutment. Suddenly there's a flash of pink. And I see this little child sitting there trembling. And I just couldn't help it. I just went and grabbed her in my arms. I could feel her trembling there. And then I learned from the people that her mother had left her that day. And yet, within an hour, she was up talking to us, smiling. There's been such a big catastrophe in her life, right? That was a choice Sushanti made that day. And I am in awe of the rural women because despite everything that happens to them, they're constantly making choices to not only be the person looking after the home and hearth, but also as the breadwinners because they work equally in the fields, right? And I felt like nothing on earth that day.
I think, sorry to butt in again, but one of the unrecognized statistics is that 65% of Indian farmers are actually women. So, in any case, women are running the show.
Yep.
And women, after a certain age, if you see even in villages, they don't wear the parda anymore. They're no longer afraid of the male gaze, you know. So, to get back to my original point, which I'm now going to make a theory, women after 50 are actually going to be our biggest resource. They're no longer afraid of the sexual gaze. They're no longer afraid of men. They feel that they've done their duty. They've done whatever society expected them to. And really, the change will come from, and it's already happening. You know, when you see the panchayats, you see the third generation of panchayat leaders, you know, all that panchpatis and all, things have changed. You do have very powerful women sarpanch leaders.
No, and yet, when I was recently in Maharashtra, in the Batata growing villages in Khed Taluka, I met a lot of women sarpanches who were dictated by the men in any case. You know, they were putting up the women there because they would get more votes. They belong to a particular community. And from what I saw in that region, the women were being dictated by their male counterparts.
Hopefully, the next generation will be different. That is what experience has shown.
This is a theory I can get behind completely, especially with my 50th birthday coming up. I'm like, yes, it's for us here. But it is true that it is very liberating not to be... I was on another panel like this where they said that everybody loves girls. Nobody loves women. You know, I mean, a girl is young, she's demure, she's submissive, she's eager to please, she's hoping to attract romantic attention. As you get older and older, none of this is on your agenda. You've like moved on. And I think, yes, that is true, that these are powerful people. But I also feel that young girls are changing as well.
Yeah.
And I think that girls, because I have daughters of 21 and 24, and their agenda is different. They're already perhaps, because generation gaps are breaking down, maybe they're talking more to these aunties who are 50 plus. And their notions of what is important in their life, their little tight little inner circle. When we were kids, we settle ho jao meant shaadi kar lo. Now settle ho jao means naukri dhoond lo, track pakad lo, find a passion that keeps you going. So I think that it's different for young girls as well. And I'm not talking rural because I don't know enough about it. Yep. But I feel our girls are also changing.
Yeah.
In fact, they are studying more than the boys in the villages. They're faring better. So that's happening. That's beginning to happen. Yeah.
So that's fantastic, actually. I think you guys are making me look forward to 50, really. That's fantastic. But
I'm already there.
Congratulations. That's what we should say. And advanced happy birthday. But one point I wanted to touch upon, you made, Nirmala, especially in certain segments, working for women or men is breadwinning, right? So it's not really a choice. But I think, like, specifically for women, I think working is less of a choice because of something else than breadwinning. And I want to say a personal story for that before I bring it in. So when I was young, growing up in Calcutta, my mom was a working woman. She didn't need to. My dad was earning pretty well. And this is what she would hear in, like, pediatrician's office, right? So my sister will have fever, and the doctor will say, of course, what do you expect for working women's children, right, in front of everyone? And I used to get very mad at my mother. When I was a teenager, she's the only one who would never show up for school functions. So I asked her one day, like, you know, why the hell do you have to work? You just don't care about your children. And she told me that, you know, if I don't be a mother, if I stop being a mother, no one will take this right away from you or anyone else. But if I stop working, many women after you might not have this chance, and you might not have this chance. So I say this everywhere, that women have a bigger responsibility to keep on working because of the numbers that we still need to build up. And on your book, Kaveri, you give that advice. Never stop working. So
caps with full stops in between.
Absolutely.
I think that's very important. And I think what we have not done enough of is actually recognize the generation of women that has gone before us and on whose shoulders we are standing. You know, our mothers, some of whom were working, some of whom didn't work because they thought that, although they had an excellent education, because they thought that, you know, exactly this argument that, you know, they had to stay at home and look after the children. But I think it's very important, especially in the current day and age where you have the numbers of working women actually declining, which is very alarming. You have a 15% decline of women in the labor force. And that could be for a variety of reasons. It could be recession. Women are the weakest link, first to fall, first to be, kicked out, I guess. But I think it's important because, A, it teaches you what the world is outside, which is the advice that Sudha Murthy has given. It teaches you how to negotiate the world outside. But more importantly, it gives you financial freedom, and we don't talk about that enough. I think that is what is important. And it teaches you to own your money, which we, again, don't do enough of. You know, you see all of us, even now, I think some of us will earn money and it goes into the family kitty and you don't really claim it as your own. I think that is changing, and I think the generation that is coming after us, hopefully, will make that change. And I think the other thing that you were saying, you know, I think it relates to Me Too as well. I think this generation of women, everyone says, what has Me Too done? It has taught them not to be gaslit. It has taught them not to be silent anymore. The powerful may still be powerful, the powerful who've sexually harassed other women, but it has taught these young women to not just roll their eyes when somebody makes a casual sexist remark and say, okay, let it be. They'll step up and say, no, this is not right. You know?
Yeah, no,
has changed.
That is a valid point. And what I wanted to actually ask is, your book also has a quote which says, like, more things change, they remain the same. In the US, I hear this all the time, that actually post-Me Too is really great. Because even though, you know, just like in India, there are a lot of acquittals of people who were initially had to resign from their jobs and stuff. Kevin Spacey is a very famous case. But the concept is that, look, this might be not something that is ending up people in prisons by score, but this is discussion on gender wages. Men and women are still not getting paid the same and stuff. And I hear a lot about how things have changed, therefore. for women. But do you see this change? You mentioned that more girls in the rural space are now studying, but do you see any other awareness changes happening in the rural segments with this?
See, women are still secondary citizens, like I said. And you see this wage earning differentiation happening when they actually migrate to the cities, right? First of all, they're paid far below. If you see a guy tarring the road in front of your house, he's taken a contract from the government. And I hear all of them speaking in that Orissa dialect, you know, Sigdi or whatever, which I've heard in the villages in Bangalore, right here in Bangalore, in front of my house. And then you go there and you try to converse with them and find out. And they're getting, first of all, both men and women are getting far below the prescribed wage limit because they're uneducated and they have no idea. The women, far less than that, right? So there is that discrimination just because they are not able to stand up for themselves. They still, they are getting something. They are running away from villages which these miners are like exploiting, right? They are mining their lands. The politicians are in hand in glove and they have nowhere to go. Their forest lands are being eaten up, right? And then little children as young as 3 are being sold off by their own families, sold off to brothels, sold off by uncles, aunts, whoever. Right? And then they come from that background and their parents are moving to Brickens where they can't take their children. So they're growing up with a very, and still with all kinds of people influencing these children in such a negative or gender, you know, negative way that it is still very, very difficult for them. No matter what's happening, it's going to take a long time, first of all, for us to get there.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, no, that is a valid point. There is still a lot that needs to be done. Anuja, advertising, somewhere you have worked your life, is actually known as one of the most sexist segments. Mad Men has kind of popularized it in the US, but I don't know if it's really that or not. I don't see tech very different, but how does things look there post Me Too or in general, how have things looked
in
there?
Advertising, actually, I beg to differ, is a place of women in the creative sectors and the, you know, the sectors of insight and planning are very respected because eventually everybody knows that the consumer is a woman. So if you're selling detergent and you're selling fairness creams and you're selling, you know, Harpic, women are buying that stuff. So they are interested. And David Ogilvy very famously said, he said, the consumer is not an idiot, the consumer is your wife. So I think in advertising particularly, there is a lot of respect and very correctly given to the woman who comes in with the insights. Again, I think the usual barriers are things that we see that, you know, you have a child and then you negotiate different kind of working hours and they think that as you hit your 30s, you're going to slip away and move on to working part-time and doing those kinds of things versus men who will come back. And, you know, if you look at office culture, guys tend to work late. They hang around in office. They'll say, we pulled an all-nighter. We were up there. It's different that they could be playing carom all night in the office and maybe sneaking in some alcohol and doing karobar in the parking lot. And so they are there all night. And girls have picked up their bags at 5:30 and said, like, bro, I have kids. I'm going home. And at home, that woman, I will tell you this, will cook the food, will feed the children, will probably have wondrous sex, I hope for her. And then at 12 o'clock, will pull her laptop out and write something which will be so amazing that all these men who stayed up all night playing carom will be like saying, we are not worthy the next day. That is women power for you. And that's how we work it, right? So I think that's not so much an advertising thing I'm talking about as just a working women thing. That's how we tend to do it.
Yeah, thank you. That's actually very, very positive and refreshing to hear. And I think that brings to a good point. I think Kaveri and I was discussing before. Now, this post Me Too or this post awareness, what I also hear a lot is this is actually really bad for women because you will now ask for extra stuff. Men will stop mentoring women now and this will close the door. So we discussed Sudhamurthy's advice, but what do you have to say in that?
I think the author that you mentioned, Laura Hirschman, talks about male hysteria. This really is male hysteria, you know, because they have to recondition their behavior, recondition their gaze, recondition their language. I mean, till recently, we used to call sexual harassment eve teasing. what sort of term is Eve teasing? Who is an Eve, you know? I mean, even the, yeah, and teasing, you know, groping a woman in a public space is not teasing. It's just harassment and it's sexual in nature. So till recently, we didn't even have the language for all this, you know? So to expect men to suddenly change is, of course, asking too much because they're not used to change, sorry. But, you know, so this male hysteria that, oh, we now have to be very careful talking to women. Yes, jolly well, yes, about time. You know, all those meetings that, I mean, I can speak from personal experience, meetings where you have these smug, middle-aged men, whom I call smams, you know, with their casual sexism and talking about covers and this woman's navel and that woman's legs or whatever. Yes, please, change the way you think. Read the Sexual Harassment Act. Read something before you go to sleep at night. Read the Sexual Harassment Act every day. I think it'll do you good. Change the way you behave. Change your gaze. Change the way you use your language. And stop trying to be a victim. I think we have this, you know, it comes from the top, unfortunately, you know, from the very top. This whole idea that the more powerful you become, the bigger your victimhood is, you know. So that has to change.
Yep. No, thank you. Absolutely agree. Thank you. And Nirmala, you want to add something to that in this problem, in the segments you work in? It's probably...
Actually, having worked in Bangalore under some very fine men, actually, Peter Colasso was my mentor, he's a famous ad man. And then there's Mr. Jayant Kodkani, who was my editor. I've worked with some very, very fine men over here who really respect women and taught us how to be who we are, you know, also as would other women too. But in the rural sector, again, I don't know how it works in the workplace because the entire village is their workplace and the home is their workplace. So, but then where they are being harassed is in terms of being trafficked or, you know, being sold off to people. And there's a lot happening in that front because of acute poverty. And I don't know, I think it happens also in the cities where people within the family are probably exploiting women, which is, I think, which happens across the course, male members across the family. So,
yep. But no, thank you. Yep. And you have anything to add to that, Anuja?
Well, I mean, you know, we can just sit here and try and prescribe solutions. But as a parent to children of both gender, I've always just told them, I said, look, two things are non-negotiable. You have to learn how to make money. No matter what your gender is, boy or girl, your whole life, never stop earning your own money. That's vital. And you need to learn how to cook for yourself. No matter, again, what your gender is, please be able to earn your own money and cook your own food. These are skills that you need. If you're anywhere tomorrow, you need these two skills. And again, I think it's, if you come to parenting, it's not so much about how we raise our girls, it's about how we raise our boys. That's so important.
And actually, that brings me to, I loved your book, Kaveri, No Regrets. That's filled with fantastic quotes, actually. And it has this quote, basically, which says, you cannot be what you can't see. Right? So role modeling for women, we talked about a little bit. Role modeling for men. So if you would like to...
Yeah, I think that's obviously extremely important. The whole idea of masculinity itself is so complex now, you know. The kind of images that you see in popular culture, you have this whole idea of toxic masculinity where the more you stalk a girl, a woman, the more romantic it is supposed to be. And the imaging that you have of men, even in our mythology, you know, we were talking about it just recently, the whole idea of the angry Hanuman, the whole idea of the martial Ram, you know. Ram was never supposed to be this muscular, martial god. He was always a forest dweller, you know. So I think all that is very important in the way masculinity is being shaped in India currently. And there are too many things that are at play. There is a different kind of masculinity that is also emerging where it's more caring, it's more equitable, the man is more sensitive. So there are lots of things that are happening at the same time. Now, which of these emerges as the role model is difficult to say, but the diversity is there. And I think that is what is important. Just as much as it is important for women to see all kinds of women in public spaces, all kinds of women in positions of power, it is important for men to see all kinds of men, the so-called house husband, which used to be laughed at. We always, you know, in India today, we used to have these talk stories, house husband, round up five men from different cities, and you know, what a great trend it is that now men are staying at home and taking care of the children. At least we don't have that kind of approach to these things now. These things are more accepted. So I think that change is happening, and popular culture, I think, plays a huge role in normalizing these. And I think the more women we see in politics, even if some of them are just there as tokens, and you don't necessarily agree with their political philosophy, which becomes very problematic sometimes, because as feminists, you all have very progressive philosophies, and then suddenly you see these women from the right wing in such positions of power, and you think, oh my God, now, you know, what is my position on this? But the fact is that they are in positions of power. How they handle that power and what they do with that power for society and for other women, I think that is what is important. That old girls network, just as you have that old boys network which plays carom all night and then says, you know, we did all the work, and it's actually the women who usually end up doing all the work. I think those are the changes that we need to see.
Yep. No, very fair. I do think that women do need to bring other women up, right? I think there is a lot of women who do that, but there is a lot of women. I have personally heard very senior women in corporate segments say stuff like, you know, I don't understand what's the big deal about stuff like Me Too. There are the French actress wrote the letter and all of that. So, yeah, absolutely.
But even men do that. So that's, I think, gender neutral.
Yeah.
Nobody wants, it's the tall poppy syndrome. Nobody wants anyone else to be better than they are, to be taller than they are.
That is true. But somehow, like, you know, personally, I get more mad when women kind of like underestimate women's issues than a man does it. I don't know, maybe. Yeah. But I wanted to touch upon a point on this role modeling. And then obviously Bollywood has been very problematic, right? They have this yes means no until very recently. And a lot of the mainstream issues, however, like, you know, this has created this whole concept of consent doesn't matter for women, or their will doesn't exist and all of it. But recently, I see a lot of things coming into mainstream, like Thappar has this Tapsi Pannu. They talk about things that a lot of people even don't know about, that there is something like restitution of conjugal right, where the man can basically come after you and force something which is not required. So
no, it was, which is why it was so encouraging to see like a mainstream popular actor like Kartik Aaryan being slapped down for that dialogue in that movie recently, where he said, agar hum juga, you know, I mean, I'm talking Hindi, but he said, if we manage to sort of, you know, do something crooked and claim our marital rights, then we are called rapists. And
yep,
people came down on him so hard for that, and yep, it's so good that they
yep
did.
Yep.
And I think a huge task for us now is to sort of make consent sexy. Like, we have made the whole uncertainty between man and woman.
Yep.
You know, you have Justin Bieber songs which
yep
say things like, you want to say yes, but you're actually saying no.
Yep.
What do you
yep
mean? And that whole uncertainty, sexual tension, flirtation, and playfulness has all been centered around this area of uncertainty, which is really scary, because that is
yep
the same area in which violence takes place.
Absolutely. Yep.
And we are sexualizing violence. We have a movie like Kabir Singh, which says that if you love each other, you can slap each other
yep
in a fit of passion, and that just shows the intensity of your feelings. So I think it's our job, and this is a literary festival, so as writers and creators of content that goes out there, it's important that we make consent sexy.
Yeah.
You know?
Absolutely.
That is very important, because right now we are renegotiating that whole space of men and women meeting socially, leading to a point where they would get together sexually. So that, I think, making consent sexy is a huge is a big thing on our agenda, at least it should be.
Yep, absolutely. And I want to just pause here, but also add that it can be done. In my next book, actually, which is on gender, I write about this song. It's a very famous song. You guys probably know. It is Baby, It's Cold Outside. It's a Christmas song. So it basically, the song actually is very, very problematic. And no one realized it because what the song is doing is the man is stopping the woman from leaving. But the song was rewritten recently with new lyrics and it became a hit too, which is basically says, baby, if you want to leave, that's still fine. I still love you. Like that, right? So, but with that, Nirmala, so what is the path to choice? What is the path to like consistent choice for women where every woman has a right to make a choice? What do you think?
See, from a very personal point of view, I had to be the breadwinner for a very long time, even being from a middle class family as an only child, whatever. In the city. And I started working at a very young age, at 13, the way Sushanti Bodhra did. And that may not have been by choice, but then, and I'm very happy for what happened to me. And now, being my own person, it is still my choice to work, right? I look after myself and whatever, and I love working. So, although sometimes what happens is, certain things happen to you in your life which is not out of choice. But then if you grow up and it matures into your choice, why not, yep. Right? And otherwise, you need to find other ways to sort of live your life more peacefully without being in the rat race. And so that's how one works towards
it. Yep. Thank you. And Kaveri, on this, your book had a line on, I think it was a quote actually.